Good day to all of you and welcome to my next lecture on Engineering Physics 5th module, Material Science. Now we'll continue the dielectric properties of the materials. In my first class that I dealt with what are dielectric materials, the definition of the dipole moment, the various types of dielectric dielectrics such as the polar and non-polar dielectrics, the definition of the polarization and the various mechanisms of polarizations. Now using these kind of concepts, let us try to understand the internal field in liquids and solids. Now to understand the internal field, let me try to take an example. You try to take a dielectric material and you try to subject to an external electric field. So I have a dipole material, dielectric material, and I'm going to subject to an external electric field. What exactly going to happen? Every atom or molecule is able to develop a certain amount of dipole moment. So let us try to consider the dipoles here are all along the single direction, that means one dimensional axis. So I will try to take a dipole, that is the x. It is an atom actually, or a molecule. So here we have applied an electric field and you can see due to the electric field, the material is going to show some amount of dipole moment here. It is going to show some amount of dipole moment. Similarly, you see the neighboring atoms A1 and A2. A1 has been placed on the left side and A2 has been placed at the left side, right side at equidistance D. So they are also going to exhibit the dipole moment along the same direction. Similarly, we try to see the B1 atom here and B2 atom. They are also been equally spaced at 2D from the center atom. They are also going to exhibit the dipole moment, and C1 and C2, which are also at 3D distance from the dipole X, they are also going to exhibit the dipole moment. And we are aware, even the net dipole moment of a net dipole of a dipole, even if there is a dipole, there is an electric field. The net charges of a dipole is going to be zero, but however, the net field is not going to be equal to zero. Now, this dipole is going to have its own electric field, But this dipole is also in the presence of the neighboring dipoles. And these neighboring dipoles are also going to have some amount of influence of the electric field over the dipole X. Even B1 and B2, which are little far away, but still they have some amount of influence of the dipole at the center. Therefore, if you consider an unknown dipole X, which has been placed at the center of all these dipoles, this dipole X has been influenced by the dipoles of or the electric fields of all the neighboring dipoles. Therefore, I can say the net resultant electric field at any given atom will be always the sum of the applied electric field and that of the field due to the surrounding dipole. And this is called as the internal field. That means here, when you apply an electric field on all these kind of molecules, every one molecule is going to exhibit some kind of dipole moment. And they have their own electric field. They have their own electric field, which is not going to be equal to zero. And this is the applied electric field. But due to the dipole moment, the neighboring dipoles are also going to exhibit some amount of electric field and that have an influence over this. Therefore, what is the net electric field at this unknown element or unknown dipole, which is always equal to the resultant sum of all the electric fields that are being influenced over the dipole X. Hence, it is said, the resultant field at any given atom is nothing but it is a X atom, will be the sum of the applied electric field and the field due to the neighboring dipoles. And this phenomenon is what we call as the internal field. Therefore, we are easily able to calculate what is the net internal electric field. And to understand that, let us say, let the total field at X, which is called as internal field, EI, is the sum of the applied electric field and that of the field due to all the dipoles. Here I very clearly said that. Here we have a dipole. You have already applied an external electric field E. and you are also going to get some amount of external electric field. Therefore, I can say that the net electric field is always equal to that of the applied field plus that of the field due to the neighboring dipoles. Here EA I will try to write. It is that applied electric field that has been applied externally. And E dash is exactly the electric field that is due to all the dipoles that are going to be present. And if you rewrite this equation and try to calculate the net electric field, you are going to get this net electric field EI is given by E divided by 1 minus 1.2 into alpha E divided by pi epsilon naught into d cube. Here, alpha E is nothing but it is an electronic polarizability. D is the distance between all successive dipoles. Epsilon naught is the dielectric medium constant of the free space. And we know that this alpha E, electronic polarizability, the applied electric field, epsilon naught, as well as the D, they're all positive quantities. Therefore, I can say, being all these kind of positive quantities, it is also a positive quantity. It is also a positive quantity. Here, 1.2 into alpha E divided by pi epsilon naught into D cube also is a positive quantity, but it is a very small quantity, which is far lesser than 1. And therefore, I can see that being the denominator is lesser than 1, the internal electric field is always going to be greater than that of the applied electric field. Here, because that the internal field is not only due to the applied electric field, but also due to the electric field due to the neighboring dipoles. Therefore, I can say EI is going to be always greater than E. And we have to remember this equation. This equation is the equation for the net internal electric field. EI is equal to E divided by 1 minus 1.2 into alpha E divided by pi epsilon naught into d cube. Now, let us try to extend this for a three-dimensional case. Whatever the equation that I have derived is for one-dimensional. Now, if the same equation has been extended to a three-dimensional case, then the general equation for the internal field is given by EI is equal to E plus gamma by epsilon naught into P. And what is this P? P is the dipole moment per unit volume, which is nothing but the polarization. And gamma is the proportionality constant called as the internal field constant. This is a constant. And this is the applied electric field. This is the total internal electric field. Therefore, for a three-dimensional case, EI is given by E plus gamma by epsilon naught into P, where P is the net polarization, that is net dipole moment per unit volume of the material. E is the applied field. And the sum of the two, which is going to be the total internal electric field. Therefore, I can say, for a cubic lattice, a physicist named Lorentz, who applied this equation for a three-dimensional cubic lattice, okay, where the value of gamma was been found to be 1 by 3. Gamma is equal to 1 by 3. Therefore, the above equation for the internal field, which has also been named after Lorentz, called as a Lorentz field, given by the equation E Lorentz, which is nothing but E internal, is equal to the applied electric field plus P divided by 3 epsilon naught, because gamma is equal to 1 by 3. Therefore, this is the total equation for the internal electric field of a three-dimensional molecule or a cubic lattice material. Okay, E Lorentz is equal to E plus P divided by 3 epsilon naught. Now let us come to an equation named Clausius-Mussotti equation. Rudolf Clausius is a German physicist, and Ottaviano-Mussotti is an Italian physicist. And these two scientists came together, brought out a relation for the electronic polarizability with the dielectric constant. And this equation was being represented as Clausius-Mussotti equation. Now, this is one of the important equations that you require to derive. So, let us try to derive this equation. And to derive, so let me consider a solid dielectric material of dielectric constant epsilon r. So, you can try to take any kind of dielectric material having a dielectric constant epsilon r. And if n is the number of atoms per unit volume of the material, per unit volume, not the number of atoms present in the given material, but per unit volume of the material, then I can add mu is the atomic dipole moment. Then we can write dipole moment per unit volume is equal to n into mu. Here mu is the dipole moment of one molecule. Such n molecules are there. Therefore, the total dipole moment per unit volume is equal to n into mu. Very simple. But what is the definition says? But the definition says that the net dipole moment per unit volume is called as a polarization. Therefore, I can write the above equation as P is equal to n into mu. I'll write the equation number 1. Therefore, the net polarization is equal to number of molecules per unit volume into the dipole moment of each molecule. But what is mu? Mu is nothing but alpha into EI, where alpha is the electronic polarizability and EI is the internal field. Therefore, I can write the above equation as, polarization is equal to P is equal to n into alpha E into EI, where only in place of mu, I have written alpha E into EI. And from this equation, I can rewrite for EI. Therefore, EI is equal to P divided by n alpha E. Just rewriting the equation number 3, I can get EI is equal to P divided by n into alpha E. So you try to take the equation number 4. Now, what is the definition of the polarization says? We know that polarization is depends on the electric field. Therefore, polarization is also equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r minus 1 into E, where epsilon r minus 1 is called chi, dielectric susceptibility. That is by definition. And from this E, I can write, which is the applied electric field, equal to P divided by epsilon naught into epsilon r minus 1. Just rewriting and write the equation number 5. That is by definition. But we have just now derived for a three-dimensional dielectric material, the internal electric field is been given by the sum of the applied electric field in plus gamma P by epsilon naught, where P is the net amount of polarization. Now what I do is that I will try to substitute the equation number 4 and equation number 5 in the equation number 6. And when I do so, I can write EI, which is nothing but P divided by N alpha E, which is equal to P divided by epsilon naught into epsilon r minus 1 plus gamma P by epsilon naught. Now here, P is a common term here. So I will get cancel all the P polarizations. So what is remaining? 1 by N alpha E is equal to, we can keep epsilon naught outside, 1 by epsilon naught into 1 by epsilon r minus 1 plus gamma. Now you try to rewrite this equation. In this rewriting, now assume that the given dielectric material is a cubic lattice, where for a cubic lattice, Lorentz already showed that gamma is equal to 1 by 3. Therefore, substituting gamma is equal to 1 by 3, I can write 1 by N alpha E is equal to 1 by epsilon naught into 1 by epsilon r minus 1 plus 1 by 3, where gamma is equal to 1 by 3. Or I can put this equation as 1 by epsilon naught, where I can write 3 into epsilon r minus is the common denominator. So on the numerator, it is epsilon r minus 1 plus 3. Or you try to rewrite this equation as epsilon naught divided by n alpha e, where this alpha naught, epsilon naught should be taken up, which is equal to epsilon r plus 2, because here 3 plus epsilon r minus 1 is epsilon r plus 2 divided by 3 into epsilon r minus 1. Or I can write epsilon r minus 1 divided by epsilon r plus 2, which is equal to n alpha e into 3 alpha naught. And this is the equation given by Clausius and Musotti, and this is called as a Clausius-Musotti relation. And this relation has a very clearly said that it relates the dielectric constant and the electronic polarizability. Because n is the number of molecules per unit volume of the material. Epsilon naught is the permittivity of the free space. Therefore, Clausius-Musotti relation says epsilon r minus 1 divided by epsilon r plus 2, which is equal to n into alpha e divided by 3 into epsilon naught. So you can remember this equation very well. This relation gives you the relation between the dielectric constant and the electronic polarizability. Now let us see what are exactly the dielectric and their applications. If you see the dielectrics, they are being divided based on their composition as solid, liquid and gaseous. When I say solid, we know their intermolecular distance is very rigid. They are called solid molecules. In the solid molecules, I have already dealt with some kind of elementary dielectric materials. Say sulfur is a basic dielectric material. Mica is a basic dielectric material. Diamond, porcelain, glass, they are all the fundamental elementary materials which are solid in nature. Or solid material can also be divided into non-polar molecule or called as and the polar molecule. And what are the non-polar dielectrics? Polyethylene is a non-polar dielectric. Polystyrene is a non-polar dielectric. Wood, sodium chloride, plastics, cotton, they are all non-polar dielectrics. But if you see the polar dielectric, we have Rochelle salt or C6H5NO2. They are also polar dielectric. So these are all the solid dielectric materials. Generally, we use mica or maybe diamond or glass or paper. So all such kind of materials are being used for our regular purposes. They are all solid in nature. Therefore, they are called as a solid dielectrics. The second composition is called as a liquid dielectric, which means to say the dielectric in terms of liquid in nature. You try to take the mineral oils or the synthetic oils, silicon liquids. Some of the example is perfluoroalkanes, purified water. They are the very good example of the liquid dielectric materials. That is the second kind. They always in liquid in nature. The third kind of dielectrics, once again the insulators, are in terms of gaseous state, like air or maybe nitrogen or maybe hydrogen or maybe sulfur, hexafluoride. All these are gaseous dielectric materials. So these are the types of dielectric material based on their nature. Now let us look into what are exactly the dielectric solid dielectrics. The solid dielectrics are good insulators and they are good supporters of electrostatic fields. They are valuable in transformers as well as in capacitors, because dielectrics are very much necessary in the case of transformers. You know, in the case of a transformer, we have a primary coil, we have a secondary coil. They are mutually connected to each other. There should not be any kind of conduction between the primary and the secondary. Hence, you require some kind of insulation. The insulators must be here, the dielectric materials. Therefore, it is being valuable in transformers. Similarly, in the case of capacitor, we have two metal plates. They have been separated by an insulating material, a dielectric material, so that the charges can be accumulated on the capacitor. So this is the solid dielectric. So we have the examples. Mica is being used in the case of a capacitor. Porcelain being used in the case of capacitor or in the case of transmission wires to isolate from the transmission and the ground. Glass is the, you know, solid dielectric. Synthetic materials like plastic, etc., they're all inorganic in nature. These are the various kind of solid dielectric materials. Similarly, we have other side of solid insulating materials like rubber or maybe cloth or maybe paper. They're all organic kind of materials. They're also very good dielectric materials. And all this dielectric, out of this, paper is hygroscopic. So it is dried and impregnated with mineral oil or vegetable oil. So if you see in the case of the capacitors, the paper dielectric generally being used after dropping or dipping this paper into some kind of oils. It is act like a very good dielectric. High density papers are preferred in DC and energy storage capacitors. See, these are some of the solid dielectrics. You can see very well in the case of the examples. We are using the mica as an inorganic material as well as in crystalline in nature. Glass is inorganic material made by fusion of different oxides. Rubber is an organic polymer which can be a natural or artificial. Ceramic is a non-metallic organic compound such as silicates, and all these such kind of materials are being used for various different kind of applications. The second kind of dielectric which you have come across is a liquid dielectrics. Here, a liquid dielectric is a liquid in its state. It has got a variety of purposes, and one of the main purposes is to prevent or rapidly quench the electric charges. The quenching is simply nothing but the discharging of the electric charges when there is a large amount of electric field being applied, especially in the case of transformers. And these dielectrics are used as electric insulators at very high voltage applications like transformers, and also used in the case of capacitors or high voltage cables, switch gears. They are also called as high voltage switch gears. These are the various liquid dielectric materials. They are all of the different nature. You know, we have mineral oils, we have oils that are been present, and these oils are been generally filled in the transformer. We have seen in the large sized transformers where the primary coils and the secondary coils, the wires are having very large thickness, and due to their large thickness, a solid dielectric cannot be inserted inside. So in such cases, we always fill the liquid dielectrics, and these liquid dielectrics will help in isolation of the primary as well as the secondary coils and gives out a very good dielectric. And they provide electric insulation. Not only that, they also serve as a coolant. So in the case of a transformer, they use both for the insulation purpose as well as a coolant purpose, because there is a large amount of heat being generated in the transformer. And during the working, the winding of an electrical device gets heated. And these liquid insulators allow the winding to cool faster by conveying the heat to the surrounding. Some of the examples of the liquid dielectrics, as I mentioned, is that transformer oils or silicon fluids or ascarils, chlorinated hydrocarbon or viscous vaseline or purified water. So these are some of the examples of the liquid dielectrics. And the last dielectric is the gaseous dielectric. And the terminology says dielectric material is in the gaseous state. And once again, it is to prevent the rapidly quenching of the electric discharges that is taking place either in the transformer or maybe in the capacitors or maybe in the other kind of appliances. So they try to provide the electric insulation. They work as a heat transferring media, because air also is a good heat transfer gas used as electric insulator in high voltage applications. Some of the examples of the gaseous dielectrics are air or nitrogen or inert gases or hydrogen, SF6, carbon dioxide. Okay, and good dielectrics have high dielectric strength. They have high thermal capacity. They should have chemical inertness against the construction materials used, non-inflammability and low toxicity, low boiling point, good heat transfer properties, and low cost. So these are some of the very good properties the gaseous dielectric material should have. You know, if in case they are having flammability, then it is a little danger. Not only that, their toxicity also may be sometimes danger. If they are very low boiling point, they boil like anything, and because of the heat that has been generated. So they require to have non-inflammability, low toxicity like this. Now let us see what are exactly their applications in the day-to-day life. The major applications of the dielectric materials are the storage devices in the case of capacitors. We have seen various kinds of capacitors, the metal plate capacitors. Between the two metal plates, a dielectric material has been used to enhance the capacitance of a capacitor. You remember the equation C is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon R into A divided by D, where with the increase in the dielectric constant, the charge and storage capacity of a capacitor can be enhanced. The commonly used paper in the case of capacitors, either paper or maybe ceramics or glass or mineral oils, okay, obtained from petroleum. Second major application is in the transformers. As I already said, when the primary and the secondary coils are being connected mutually, you require to have very good isolation or insulation between them. So you require very good dielectrics in the transformers. So here we used in cables as a spark generators or as transducers. Similarly, paper insulators are used in the transformers. Thick coils, there exists a large air gap, which sometimes ionizes the air at high voltages, leading to excess heating and damaging the insulation. This is called as a corona. Actually, this process is what we call as a quenching. Because when there are thick wires are being wound, there is a large gap between the air, the wires. And where the air molecules that are being present at very high voltages, they are going to become conducting charge particles. And then it will try to damage the material. And what exactly the heating and damaging formation at the center is what we call as a corona. So generally, mica has been used to guard against the corona. And the best thing is that you have to use the transformer oils, because these oils can easily penetrate into those corners where quenching can be avoided. Therefore, transformer oils are generally being used in the high voltage transformers. Oil helps the transformer not only to avoid quenching, but also to cool down the temperature that has been present in the transformer. Olefin oils, naphthalene oils, paraffin oils, they're all the better insulating materials are being generally used. So these are the various kind of applications of the dielectric materials. I hope you understood what is a dielectric material, what are the types of dielectric material, what are exactly the dielectric constant, and the amount of polarization that is going to take place, the relation between the electric polarizability and that of the dielectric constant, the various mechanisms of the polarization, and the various applications of the dielectric materials. So this is all about the dielectric properties of the materials. So I have two problems to work out. Okay, so let us look into the next problem. Find the polarization produced in a dielectric medium of relative permittivity 15 in presence of an electric field of 500 volt per meter. So here we require to calculate the polarization that is produced in the dielectric medium where the dielectric constant is 15 in the presence of the electric field of 500 volt per meter. So what are the data given? You are given relative permittivity is equal to 15 given there. Strength of the electric field is given as 500 volt per meter. Now we require to calculate the polarization. What is the equation for polarization? Polarization P is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon R minus 1 into E. Here epsilon naught is the permittivity of the free space, which is equal to 8.854 into 10 power minus 12. Epsilon R minus 1 is 15 minus 1 into E is 500. So if you substitute and calculate, it is going to give you 6.198 into 10 power minus 8 coulomb meter per meter square. This is the amount of polarization taking place in the material. We have one more problem. The dielectric constant of sulfur is 3.4. Assuming a cubic lattice for its structure, calculate the electronic polarizability of sulfur given density of the sulfur is 2.07 gram per cc and atomic weight is 32.07. So we require to calculate the electronic polarizability of the sulfur, where the data given here, the dielectric constant of the sulfur is 3.4. And it is very clearly said that it is a cubic lattice, so gamma should be equal to 1 by 3. Then the density is given as 2.07 If you convert in terms of kg per meter cube, it is 3.07 into 10 power 3 kg per meter cube. And its atomic weight is 32.07. Now, since it is very clearly said that the crystal is a cubic lattice, the Clausius-Mussert equation very well true. The equation is epsilon r minus 1 divided by epsilon r plus 2, which is equal to n alpha e into 3 epsilon naught. So here we require to calculate electronic polarizability. So if you try to substitute, you are going to calculate the value of the electronic polarizability. So you please substitute and find the value of the electronic polarizability. With this, I'll try to complete my class. Thank you very much for listening.